This is the right
version. Yeah.
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 Okay.
Norsk, men ikke så fantastisk bra det svært. On technical matters, I would rather make sure to understand one another.
It's not the book, right? No? Okay.
It's
not,
yes.
I just sent you the foils, but I'm not sure I'm using it.
No problem.
No, but it's up to you. I just send it on the mail.
No, it's somebody before me.
Yeah, he's only introducing you.
Yes, I'm here.
There are some.
Welcome to Itera, yes?
I'm sorry for too late because I misunderstand Aadne.
No.
I thought he sent it to you.
I would like you to take the questions within this scope of time.
Within this scope, very good.
So if you want me to sort of to be in charge of the questions.
No, I can do it myself, particularly since time is limited and so I need to really squeeze myself.
I don't know if you want to take the questions during the
performance. I can. Is it different?
What does it mean in Russian?
No, it's just a sample of abbreviation. It was a company which was doing a lot of gas business.
That's true.
And it was subsumed by gas.
Yeah, that's true. So it was oil and gas companies that has been now merged into something bigger.
Yeah, Gazprom.
But Gazprom, I think, took it over.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. And Itera is also.
Everything okay? Everything very smart
today. Very busy stuff. Okay, so for that, you're
like, I'm
going to
say. Itera, yeah. Dagens Aadne.
Aadne
her i Stockholm og selv et selskap selv.
Ja vel.
Som var signering i dag. Sånn old by.
Så skulle det vært i går.
Så skulle det vært for 2 måneder siden.
For 2 måneder siden.
Ja, det har blitt utsatt. Jeg håper vi har faktisk signert akkurat når vi synes det var klart.
Ja,
fire
de møtte.
Hvem ville ha den?
Noen lurte deg til å kjøpe sånne automatisk klokker.
Det ikke sant, ingenting automatisk klokker.
Sånn som trekker seg opp med håndbevegelsene, men nå må man lukke av noe. 14.01,
ja.
Ja. Det er tid å begynne å gjøre noe.
Er dette en tvil? Salen? Det var så vidt jo.
Det
var så vidt jeg ville komme når jeg så det, altså.
Er ikke du vidt sånn?
Jeg tror hvis du tenker om vet at jeg har en klokker.
Åja, det er
stabilt. Et bedre lag.
Nei, jeg tror ikke vi tar noe for å spille her faktisk, bortsett fra at jeg tror de får fotball, eller inntektene, tror jeg faktisk går til Ulva Stadion og AS.
De griner seg til den nye banen
oppe
på
Valle
for 1 kroner.
Men det har de ikke råd til å bygge da, så ser jeg jo like langt.
Så lenge de har en så dårlig trener, så kommer de til å holde seg i hjørnet.
Jeg tror jeg har overlappet til dere også.
Ja, er du
lyngutt,
er du klar?
Nei, jeg er lyngutt,
ja. Ja, jeg er lyngutt. Du og Finn Bjerke?
Jeg var nå å legge ned lyd. Ja, han var også der jeg møtte han flere.
Men nå skal han få kjørt seg hos Onkel Jon.
Ja, han
har jo hatt noe strøy. Nei, han har ikke lov til å jobbe med Olav, det gjør han ikke. Han skal jobbe med å strukturere hele konsernet til Bøksen, alle selskapene. De har spilt litt, ja. Men de har, men Trøm var mye mer på start og forretning. Nå er det snakk om å sikre døtterne en pensjon. Hvis jeg skjønner det riktig.
De har vel dyre vanlige jentene.
Well, you can just start with my presentation and then
you will start with me.
Thank you.
Jeg trenger ikke det. Do you think I need it?
Okay. Yes, well.
Is it on? Okay, I'm ready to start it. Okay, then I think everyone, almost everyone is seated. I just want to welcome you to this networking meeting and show you the program. There are some changes in the program because people have to go on business trips and the like, but to Halvorsen, he's not here. My name is Sigmund Ekhaven, so I'm sort of his stand-in, just saying welcome. Then we will, this meeting is sponsored by Itera. So first of all, we like to give the word to our host and sponsor. Yvonne will be there.
That's me.
There you are. But we have one from the management saying hello before that. And then we have the academia. Isn't that correct? Professor Baev from Rio will give us his view on how unstable the investment environments are in Ukraine. Don't frighten us too much, please. Then there's a coffee break, and after that we're talking about local democracy reforms. Someone says that the key to get some thing to happen in Ukraine now is to move decision authorities from Kyiv out in the region. So I hope that's what we're going to talk about. And last, we are talking a bit about news from the chamber, what we have done for the last month and what we intend to do for the next month. And after that again, there is, someone told me it's Norwegian tapas. It's a strange expression, but something to eat and something to drink. And the main point from our, the main issue from our point of view is not sort of the eating, but it's a mingling. It's a way of sharing experience in an informal way. But, first of all, you know, as some guy who paid for this, I leave the microphone to you.
Thank you. Can you all hear me?
Yeah.
Okay.
I can use it.
I'll use it. Thank you. Okay, I'll see if I'm able to use it. Is that the pointer? Okay, first of all, most welcome. I'm a proud host of this event on behalf of Aadne, the CEO of Itera. He had to, on a very short notice, to go to Stockholm this morning on a business trip, but he gives his regards to all of you and hope you have an excellent afternoon. Most of you that know that we are in a football stadium used by Vålerenga soccer club. Not all of us are fan of that club, but we can live with it still. My name is Jon Erik Høgberg. I'm a CEO of Itera Norge AS. I was part of the startup in Ukraine for Itera in 2008 in the summertime. So I've been with the Ukrainian situation and the expansion we have done there for many, many years, both in Lviv and in Kyiv. And I'm extremely proud of the destination we chose, being Kyiv and Lviv, and the remarkable results we have achieved in our customer arenas. of development of applications, but also of governance of the organization of the corporate Itera. People are extremely well educated in Ukraine. They are disciplined, extremely loyal, and very well, should we say, as colleagues. Very including, socially intelligent people. So I'm extremely high fan of my colleagues of Ukraine. So I'll just give you a very short introduction to Itera. Anyone of you who knows Itera from before? I know you are customers of Itera. More to come, hopefully. But we are a company listed on the Norwegian Stock Exchange as ITE. We are approximately 460 employees. We have some values, as most companies do. But there's one thing that sticks out when we talked about our Ukrainian colleagues, and they are both passionate and extremely skilled. They are passionate for their work, passionate for the employer, and passionate for all the customers, and extremely well skilled. I've met so many colleagues over there for the last years, and I'm impressed of the educational level. I usually say that they exceed NTNU of Norway of the same time in school when it comes to mathematics and the physical, the real fag, so in the real context. We are companies in Norway, Sweden and Denmark as well, but the main office is in Norway, where we have the group headquarters as well. We are working across five main areas of business. Social networking, you know that in the digital area, mobile applications, big data, BI, business intelligence solutions, and the cloud services and Internet of Things. We will be all connected in the future, even though we don't like it at all times, but we are part of a big, big internet that connects us all together. So we are working with these services across. In Ukraine, we especially have consulting skills, service design skills, system development, and now we are moving into cloud areas as well. And we are just about to get the approval to do management of systems outside European Union in something we call business corporate rules for providers. So we made a decision some years ago in 2008 in the spring that we needed a multi-site strategy. We needed nearshore capacity, and we traveled the world in Eastern Europe, in Central Europe, and in Asia and in India. And we ended up with Ukraine, most of all because the educational skills. Second, the culture differences were not that much different from the Nordic countries. There are so extremely many similarities from the old time of the Vikings when they travel across. You will be amazed if you read the books. There are some culture similarities, but we also have the population. We found that the Ukrainian society educates a lot of competent people, more than any European country, or for the purpose what we needed. So those were the kind of reasons why we chose Ukraine as a destination. We have also chosen Bratislava in Slovakia as a third, or excuse me, second location for nearshoring. And there are reasons for that. The turmoil with the Maidan and everything resisted a lot of customers, especially in the banking and finance areas in Norway and Sweden, to be reluctant to expand. But now we see that this and they are now investing again together with us in order to be inside the European Union for that kind of questions. So, and we also are working a lot with something called data protection law compliance. I think we are one of the first providers in the IT service area, in at least in Norway, that has now applied for this. And we were told that the application should be approved now in June. That means that we have, all the Itera, the corporate rules that we have, into the EU compliance regulations. So we can use Ukrainian destination to be likewise as the Norwegian, Swedish or Danish, under the same laws and regulations. And at that time we are able to do management of systems and applications from Ukraine. under the same laws of especially personal data protection laws. And that's quite vital to us, because then we can really scale on the competency and of course level of cost. So are there any questions to Itera before I introduce my good friend Ivan? Crystal clear? Okay, Ivan, please.
Don't need to use the microphone. I think everybody can hear me, right?
No, because you need a record.
It's as long as you are in the camera.
It's for the record.
No. So my name is Ivan, and I come from Ukraine. So I'm an example of hopefully fascinating Ukrainian colleague. I've just been asked by Aadne, who had to go to Sweden to do this presentation and to speak about why Ukraine is a superior option to most IT outsourcing destinations. That was a wow question to me, because I'll be brutally honest. 2 weeks ago, I was in Amsterdam at a shared services event. There were big companies like Deutsche Telekom and UniCredit and Siemens and what so not. And there were booths from many countries like Uruguay, Morocco, Egypt, India, you name it. There are tons of outsourcing destinations out there. So in my presentation, I'll just speak about Ukraine. I can't claim we are the best, but we have something that I believe we are best at. Short about Itera, I will skip because you got it already from Jon Erik. So I will skip straight away to why Ukraine as an IT outsourcing destination. So these are the plain facts. The first one is yes, we have over 50,000 employees working in IT outsourcing. In brackets, I specifically put 200,000, because 200,000 is anybody who could work in IT. So they're working for some sysadmin in a factory, you know, for a local provider somewhere, but this is not IT outsourcing where they're English speaking. And on annual basis, we get about 30,000 graduates. Again, this is for anyone who can work in IT. If we're talking about IT outsourcing, the number is lower, that is about 20,000. Because in IT outsourcing, the level of proficiency might be higher. Then, next very important question for many when they go to outsourcing is the cost. The average salary in IT is $1,760 per month, USD, all inclusive. Yes, I represent here the industry that is very different from any other industry in Ukraine, with the highest salaries and being the most protected industry in the turmoil events that have happened last year. And over the last years, the estimated export value of the IT outsourcing industry was $2 billion. This pretty much is a summary of Aadne Mjos' quote of what Jon Erik was mentioning, why they have chosen Ukraine. So just to reiterate, it's for lower wages compared to EU, and that's one of the reasons that many come to Ukraine. There's a high competence of employees, hopefully I'm a good example of that, and there's a close cultural proximity. So when we talk about outsourcing, what I say to many people who come to Ukraine, and by the way, I've been working in this industry in Ukraine for 7 years and helped clients start up their teams from sizes of 2 to 350 people. So what I tell them, you know, IT outsourcing is a classical example of economics by the book, meaning the barrier to entry is lowest. All you need is electricity and internet. But there's a key ingredient, which is the human brain, which is something that you cannot automate. And this is where in IT, in order to be superior, you need innovation, you need thinking outside the box, and you need passion. Otherwise, you cannot create tomorrow's IT product. And this is what I think Ukraine is good for. Our asset is the brain. So right now, there's like lots and lots of statistics when you go on the internet about, you know, Ukraine, some is too high, some is too low, so go somewhere in the middle, because, you know, it's the media. But here I wanted to point out that we are, by the 2015, WEF report. We are on the 30th place by the quality of education in IT. We are talking about overall IT. So these are the rankings, and let's see, the other Eastern European countries, they are way behind us. And we are on the 13th place by population with a university degree. 97.5% of our population has a 79.7% has a university degree. And we are on the second most master level certified nation and third most certified citizens by the BrainBay Global Skills Competition 2013. Guess who is in front of us? USA when we are second, and when we are third, it's USA and India. In 2014, IT outsourcing market in Eastern Europe, Ukraine, takes the largest position. And it's estimated that it's going to go further. We are in the top 30 outsourcing destinations if we're talking globally. And we are third place for freelancers right after USA and India. If you start reading many reports, you always will notice that we are coming very close with Indians and USA citizens. And by the way, if you go to USA, you'll find out that many of those citizens are of Ukrainian descent. And the World Bank predicts that in 2015, Ukraine will be the sixth largest exporter of software development in the globe. Okay? By the way, I everywhere put up the sourcing and links, so afterwards, maybe if you want, you can contact the guys and they can share the presentations with you. All of this is publicly available information, right? I just know where to search because, you know, I'm a Ukrainian and been in this industry for a very long time. So this is just an overview of the top cities. We have five top cities, obviously Kyiv, Kharkiv, Lviv, Dnipropetrovsk, Odessa. I assume all of you know about Ukraine, given you're here. And if we're talking about IT involvement, 61% goes for outsourcing. And you can see that the product is the next line. And here in this product is actually not Ukrainian product. Most of it is foreign companies that are developing the product in Ukraine, right? Startups, that's the only part where it's true Ukrainian. And last year, due to the situation, we have seen an increased streamline of startups going up. And other, I'm not sure what other in this report means, but I will not go in details. And one thing to remember for all the foreigners that come in, and I always remind this, you know, there is a competition because there is no unemployed IT specialist in Ukraine. Everyone is hired, and this is the statistics for 2014 from a very credible source. We have an independent community of software developers. It's actually one of the most credible sources in Eastern Europe for salary statistics, reviews on the companies, and so on. And last year, we had 2,000 job openings in Ukraine overall. 1,000 comes from the top 25 companies, and I'm being very brutally honest because I always tell clients honesty, because in Ukraine, that's what we, let's say, sell: trust, transparency, honesty, at least in IT. You see, if you go down 2008 and to 2013, you will see a very steady growth. So in 2013, before the events, we achieved a 24,000 growth annually. Now in 2014, obviously it has declined. I mean, that's a no-brainer. But the industry has still grown. It has grown in terms of value. It has grown in terms of customers. It has grown in terms of employees being entered into the IT outsourcing world. There are many, many companies here, that are using Ukrainian outsourcing developers. I've put here, you know, the most prominent ones that you probably know. So I'm not going to read the names, but I can tell you from those that are not Scandinavians, the other big names are UBS Bank, Barclays Bank, Deutsche Telekom, Playtech. There are many, many companies. There's Samsung, over 1,000 people. So IT is huge. Now, what about the trend? The trend is United IT Ukraine. For many that you have been to Ukraine, you know that on our TV it's all about, you know, keeping one Ukraine. But also in IT, we are all staying together, and Ukrainian IT industry was the first one to, let's say, jump in and start being united and show evidence of the work being done. So, well, in 2014, what we have seen is a strong push from the government and industry players. First, the government declared IT industry should become a more important export market in Ukraine, target to reach 20 million USD in 10 years. And also, another part is upgrade and expand IT education system. In IT industry, so that's the government, that's the other side. Now we are on the buy side. We need a better promotion of Ukraine on the global market, and by meaning support us by giving us jobs, and we should attract, educate more resources. So on the second paragraph, we pretty much matched. They want, and the first one as well, they wanted more expert and we want more clients. They want a better education. We need a better education because we need more skilled people. So what did it resulted in? First one, there are many, many new initiatives, associations, programs going on. Why did I put Richard Branson? He was recently in Ukraine talking at One Forum Ukraine, and that's pretty much his quote about, it's not just words and videos, which we have seen over the last year, but it's about creating jobs, and it's about new skills. So the goal that the IT has set up for itself, actually, we want 100,000 people, also want billion expert industry. So pretty much we are aligned, and here we match. And here at the bottom, I put down, you know, Brain Basket Foundation. They do a lot of initiatives on that front. Digital Ukraine, another association that's situated by software vendors, because Brain Basket is more about IT outsourcing area, and these decided, you know, we are vendors, we are hardware, we want to stay separate from the crowd. And then there's also Bionic University, which is a high-tech park initiative. It was there before. Those two things are brand new. This was before, but they started to do more and more things. There are more organizations to list, but if you're interested, you can always email me, or you can start by searching these ones, and then you will easily find links to the other ones, because IT industry is very transparent. We are not trying to hide information, because when you come to us and, you know, we sell you something that you don't get, you will easily leave us. The competition is global. Then there are, let's say, other side of initiatives. So one of them is the US Embassy, and what they've started is increase profits, support democracy, cloud source to Ukraine. So if you go to cloud source to Ukraine, it's pretty much an initiative where US Embassy in the United States, they are promoting democracy by creating jobs in Ukraine. That's how to support us. And that's the best way to actually contribute to Ukrainian economy, is by creating jobs, right? It's like, I can't remember the country where we have beggars, it's a penny job. Embassy stipulated one. And this is independently by the IT companies, and it's called US Support Organization, and you get a lot of information. And NUCC is part is a member of this organization as well. Pretty much everybody who wants to support Ukraine is part of that organization. Then I want to tell you about one more program. Many of you are here are supporting, the ATO. So this is Coding for the Future project. This is for all people who are leaving that territory, anti-terrorist operation territory. When they're leaving, they are able to actually upgrade themselves and go into IT. So we, in Ukraine, now there is a program where they can enter, the easiest way to enter the IT world is becoming a tester. So right now you already see, this was launched about maybe half a year ago. So there are already 1,300 registered, over 600 applied, and 40 people studying, and that will go more, because obviously you can't train everybody. You have to do some pre-qualifications exams, and if you can't pass the exam, you first need to learn those things in order to pass the exam, and then you can do it. But still, the program is open for those who are interested to enter the IT world. And then there's a lot of events happening in Ukraine to promote the industry. And by promoting the industry, I mean to promote to other young generation, to others working in different industries to enter IT outsourcing world. So this is an example of a very large event happening in March, over 5,000 people. This event was always there. It was an annual event, but this year it was, I mean, the theme was education and getting a job in IT. And actually what they've done is they have awarded or actually sourced for all the different programs that are increasing IT knowledge in Ukraine for people to enter the IT world. So there were 46 nominees for IT education awards, and no government-sponsored programs were allowed to be here. So these are only all independent programs, and most of these programs have started last year. If you go on this website, you can read, it's all in English, there are many of them, and it's not all, it's only those who chose to apply. So looking ahead, in 2014, there were a lot of people that have joined from the software development business, the government. We see a positive trend in terms of reforms, at least for the IT industry. In 2015, we see a further strong unification of IT community. So at least in IT, I'm always pointing at IT because IT is a different industry, like nothing else in Ukraine. IT is doing a lot to help the country. And it's known that any crisis is the beginning of changes. So we have to live through changes and we have to accept it, and we're doing our best to come best out of it. So just to finish up, why Ukraine? So when I was asked by Aadne to do this presentation, I was like, okay, you know, Ukraine, best outsourcing destination. Let me post on Facebook and LinkedIn, because that's where IT world lives, and ask my clients and friends, you know, why would they come to Ukraine? And one of the clients, actually, I know him very well, a very robust client, he started talking about the usual things, you know, the times, no time zone hell, distributed teams can work, and here in brackets I've added, but you have to find a partner that knows how it's done right. It's not just like coming, yeah, I'll set it up easily. Ukrainians are highly motivated, the cost, you know, the usual. But I told him, okay, you know, if I'm from Poland, I pretty much can say the same. And if you know, in the sales process, the majority of the buy-in is done by how good the salesperson is. So if there's a good salesperson from Ukraine and a good salesperson from Poland, they can pretty much say these things. I was like, what else can you say about Ukraine that will make a difference? This is what he wrote to me. We found people with similar drive to us, if not a stronger drive. I think the only thing you can compare between Poland and all is Ukrainian mindset. The drive to learn and be technologically innovative to ensure a good job and a good standard of living. Yes, in IT world, we are privileged that we are working in the highest paid and most, let's say, upfront industry. Therefore, there are a lot of people who want to become part of it. And yes, Ukrainians, by nature, and given our background in the Soviet Union, strong mathematical, physical school, blah, 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 this is an area that we are good in, and we understand it, and we're trying to be even better. That's it. Thank you. These are some of the links to, you know, most prominent websites. The report, actually, up-to-date report, 2015 report from the American Chamber of Commerce, on Ukraine, and it covers all the industries, not just IT, agriculture, you name it. And there's my contacts if you need.
We are streaming this presentation, so you can go into YouTube and find the presentation there. And for those who are members, you're also able to find all the slides on our homepage. That's only for members. So if you want to go into the references, we have time for one question, maybe.
Anyone wants to ask? Yeah.
Are you still expanding in Ukraine?
You mean Itera?
Itera, yes.
Yes. And as I shown there, all the companies are expanding. Yes, we're not in top 25, but we are expanding. And in Itera, the decision is for one onshore resource hire. So in order to expand by one person in Norway, we need to expand by five people in Ukraine. That's our ratio.
Okay, thank you, Ivan.
It's very good to be here, and I'm very glad about the opportunity to share with you my worries and concerns. And I will try to cut myself shorter and leave a bit of time for questions, because, again, most of my headlines are about questions, and I cannot really pretend convincingly that I have the answers. Ukraine is a very complicated mess, and the simplest answer to that question, which was raised to me, is yes. Very, very unstable. That's a picture from yesterday in Mariana. As you can see, it's not really small arms fire. At the same time, no investor will be satisfied with this sort of straightforward question. And I have to say that Ukraine is still a place where it's entirely possible to work, as we have just heard from Itera. The war zone is very localized. Outside of that, it's very little of instability, of violence. There are certainly all sort of risk factors, and I cannot really give you an overview. There is a risk of sovereign default, and there is a risk of corruption and whatnot. I am not really an expert on Ukraine. I will concentrate only on one risk factor, which is Russia, and it's a serious one. All right, let me figure out how this works. No? Yes. I have to say that this last year and something for me really feels like that. It's not something you ever thought about. It is a territory unthinkable. And we are going deeper and deeper into that territory every day. It is a very depressing topic in many ways. It's not really something I feel enthusiastic about in any way, though certainly for every researcher, when there is demand, when you feel that your expertise is required, should be a source of positive feeling. I cannot really say this is the case here. And the destination we are traveling in this territory of unthinkable is very unclear. It is not something you can speak about with any degree of confidence. It's not one of those situations where you can apply a model and see where it's going, where trajectory is kind of clear and settled, and where you can have any predictability. Again, it looks very different across many parts of Ukraine, and I agree that, for instance, in Lviv, it probably doesn't look like that at all. I have just have a couple of friends from Moscow who traveled there, and are very impressed with the depth of cultural soil in Lviv, how it feels there, what sort of feeling it is. At the same time, another friend of mine is now with the OSCE observers in Donetsk and in Luhansk, and it really, his impressions are definitely very different. This very peculiar kind of conflict, which is very often called hybrid war, generates a very particular fog. Every war generates its own fog. Clausewitz noted that a couple of hundred years ago. This war generates incredible amount of uncertainty, of lies and propaganda. What is data, what is evidence, and what is lies and propaganda is very hard to say. This military show in Moscow on May 9 is indeed a part of the same hybrid war. It is an attempt to make an impression of what is really happening there and where it goes. There is so much denial about that on the Russian side. There is so much, I will not say only on the Russian side, but on the Ukrainian side as well. The country is in war. It needs to mobilize every source of support it has. I cannot really blame them for that, but it is very difficult for a researcher to get to the bottom of what is really happening and why and what to expect. Again, it's probably a feature of most wars. They never go as expected. And when strategic thinking was about what might possibly happen, how the next war might look, there were all sorts of ideas about how it might look, including the ideas that the cyber dimension of future war is seen as extremely important. There is no cyber dimension for that, in that conflict whatsoever. That war, which is going on in that particular corner of Ukraine, looks in many ways very strange because it's not a modern war. It looks like very old-fashioned trench warfare with some kind of tank battles and some artillery exchanges, but nothing of the modern battlefield. No drones, for that matter. Nothing of air power whatsoever. Everything is happening on the ground and in a lot of dirt. So again, whether this war will continue along this line, it is hard to say. But it's certainly something which has taken a lot of military people, a lot of strategists by surprise. When the war started, when the conflict started, better to say, in Crimea, we saw one sort of performance on the Russian side, and it was a very impressive performance. These polite green men arrived to Crimea, they were very professional, very effective, no violence whatsoever, really a huge difference from the Russian army you would expect to see, which made a strong impression on many on the NATO side. What is happening in Donbass looks very different, and those green men are not polite at all. They are pretty ugly, and some of them look like the Russian or Ukrainians, probably that platoon most probably comes from Chechnya, and the behavior is accordingly. It is, in a sense, a complete mess. Even that territory, which is effectively under rebel control, is an incredible violent mess. They cannot establish anything resembling an efficient control over that. There is constant fighting, killing one another. It is, in many ways, again, that very territory of unthinkable. We don't know how to deal with, you know, after all, in Donetsk, just a few years ago, it was European football championship, and it looked perfectly normal. That was really, certainly, that is a big question. What is this risk factor about? What Russia really wants? Is it just Crimea? Russia not just occupied Crimea, but officially incorporated Crimea into Russia, made it another region inside the Russian Federation. Is that really what is the whole thing about? Or is it a larger design about splitting Ukraine, about establishing Novorossiya of sorts? Or maybe that fighting in Donbass is just a cover-up for incorporating Crimea, and Russia is trying to bargain away these rebels. In my reading of the situation, it is not really about Crimea or about Novorossiya. It's not really about territorial expansion. It is not, in a sense, something in kind of Russian expansionism imminent there. I think it's much more about that drive about which Ivan was saying, which was so very evident in the streets of Kiev in autumn of the year 13. Another of the Ukrainian uprisings, and very much under the European flag, much to the dismay of many in Brussels, because they have really no plans for any way accepting Ukraine into the European Union. But the drive this idea generates in Kyiv and in Lviv is really very strong. And for President Putin and his Kremlin, that was a colossal threat. That Ukraine not only gradually drifts towards Europe, but suddenly generates a breakthrough. That suddenly it is this liberating feeling that we don't need this corrupt regime, that we can we deserve better. And it's not about Ukraine, it's about Moscow as well. Putin is in a very defensive frame of mind. He's struggling against this specter of revolution. That's his main worry and his main concern. But again, Russia in the defensive frame of mind is very dangerous. It is very risky. Probably, again, from the rational economic investor perspective, that is the most interesting feature of the development in the last year and a half. Typically, a war generates an economic boost. not always very strong, not always very very sustainable, but nevertheless, the state is mobilizing, invests in this and that. The war effort generates an economic boost. Nothing of the sort is happening in Russia. Yes, there is a lot of patriotic mobilization and propaganda-wise, but nobody is really prepared to work any harder for this war. That's one of this very obvious feature. And the capital, the investment capital, flows out in Russia, not probably as strong as it did in the year 8 and 9, but nevertheless very considerably. There is an outflow of capital, capital flight, and it's not foreign capital in the sense, it's not foreign investors who are disappearing, primarily that those are kind of Russian businessmen. There is a lot of money accumulated in Russia, and it flows away because a lot of the businessmen in Russia do not believe in the future of this situation. It is hard in Ukraine, certainly. The economic situation there looks pretty grim. And again, every investor would probably think twice about going there. But what is going on in Russia has a difference in scale in this regard. The economy very often in the war is the decisive factor. And in the pause which has been happening for the months of this year, suddenly the economic factor comes to the front. That Russia is not just in the comfortable stagnation like Zastoy, it is in the very pronounced economic decline, and every monthly bunch of statistics brings you more of that. You cannot talk it out of existence, hard as they try. One particular economic dimension, surprisingly, which is kind of bracketed out from that conflict, is gas, is energy. And Russian, Ukrainian, European energy issues have been there for a long time. There were kind of gas wars and gas skirmishes, interruptions there, quite a few of them. And nothing of the sort during this war, real war, shooting war, but gas flows. Nobody is prepared to fool with that. Yes, there are a lot of talks in Moscow about diverting the gas flow towards China, about building another pipeline through the Black Sea, not probably the South Stream, maybe the Turkish Stream. Please ask me questions about that. But the fact of the matter is that that is not affected by the war at all, surprisingly. What is affected by the war is Gazprom's position in Europe. Europe is very consciously, deliberately reducing the import of gas from Russia. Norway is now exporting more gas to Europe than Russia. Gazprom, quarter after quarter, you see the figures show the same trend. It's not about interruptions, it is about the demand factor. And the question which looms large every day I switch on my news is that, and again, European leaders, one again and again, come to Moscow, it was Merkel visiting Putin recently, and try to say, you should stop, enough is enough, you have gone far enough. Merkel used some very strong language, so strong that Russian interpreters prefer not to translate. But at least Putin speaks German, so probably he got the message. Talking probably is not enough, because Putin has created for himself a self-made trap with this conflict. And every time there is a pause, suddenly he feels that he's losing. He feels that situation changes against him. First of all, because of the economy, but because many other things as well, because of Ukraine, after all. So that those are the pictures from the northern Norway, where as we speak, exercises are happening. They're busy in Bodø, so to say, and it's a big air force exercise with the participation not only of the Nordic states, but of so Switzerland is there. With its air force, and it's an attempt to show to Russia that no experiments with power projection in the north would be tolerated. It's not a good idea. Rogozin's visit to Svalbard was bad enough. Don't even think about playing with your military force here. And I don't think he is really playing with the military force in the Arctic or in the Baltic area, where possible gains are slim, possible risks are very high, but Ukraine is still in serious danger. question here. You know, that picture hit my Facebook some years ago. I was impressed by the graphics, and that's very much how they think about this conflict in Russia now. It's not about local wars on in Ukraine. It is really this, you know, conflict between good and evil. That's kind of that's what that the war is about. And so the question of whether it's called war, you look at these pictures, you say, well, maybe not exactly, but something similar. No confrontation resembles one another. There are certain differences, but the mindsets are certainly far, even far stronger than we had it in the last stages of Cold War. The difference is, I am old enough to remember the Cold War. You know, back then in Eastern Germany, there was about 500,000 of Russian troops kind of looking across the border. Grouping was kind of really colossal strength. And again, war has changed. You know, now probably it's more efficient. You don't need that many people and tanks. But when Brezhnev decided in 68 that he will need to stop the Prague Spring, that he needs to occupy the defenseless Czechoslovakia, he moved in there about 400,000 troops, very quickly, very effectively. The Prague Spring was suppressed. But 400,000 troops is something Russia doesn't have now. When you hear what is concentrated on the border of Ukraine, you say, you sometimes hear 50,000, sometimes you hear 60,000, but it's an order of magnitude of difference. Russia does not have really power to occupy Ukraine. It probably will be playing again and again, trying to score small victories, maybe trying to blaze the corridor towards Crimea. Let me not rush with that one, because Crimea is fairly isolated and vulnerable in many ways, including water supply. But occupying Ukraine is really beyond Russia's grasp. So experimenting with power projection, Russia has to set its mind on a different scale. It cannot really replay that success of the year 68. And there are all sorts of ways of thinking in Russia how to use the only advantage Russia has, which is a military advantage. The readiness to deploy military force, which is kind of against, puts Russia apart from many other European countries, the readiness to take casualties. Nowhere in Europe you have the same attitude. And I would say probably it's not enough for Merkel to come there and not enough for the exercises in the North to be, I think, a very important factor in dissuading Russia from that is China. And during this year and a half, there was a big change in Russia-China relations. Russia is now in a very different position vis-a-vis China, and kind of the ideas about kind of like that, I think it's from Financial Times, that cartoon that Russia and China will together play in a big league. Well, they're not at all shared in China. In China, there is a very serious line of thinking about new type of great power relationship between China and the United States. Russia is not a part of this game as far as China is concerned, and China wants this conflict contained. China wants this very kind of risky experiment with use of power to stop. And in many areas, you see less and less of coinciding of Russia and China interests, including in the Middle East, where Russia is very keen to play a spoiler game, primarily because it wants oil prices to go up. And China is not interested in oil prices in going up. So there is not much of a coincidence of interest, not much of a coincidence of interest in the Arctic, because Russia is very much about kind of keeping Arctic to itself, and China thinks that it is a global common, essentially, where it is probably most pronounced, and where my gravest worries are, is about the nuclear dimension. Russia has invested a lot during the last kind of 5, 7, 8, 10 years in its nuclear capabilities. And now that's a real war, and your investment in nuclear power is wasted, essentially. Had you invested that differently, you'd have more capabilities for that war. But you need to make your investments work. How to put the nuclear weapons into political game? That's a difficult question. And maybe all sort of thinking about that, including resumption of nuclear tests. But China, again, is a very serious containing factor in that. And so I hope my best hope is that the combination of Western pressure and kind of Chinese reluctance to undermine the global system in which China is the main beneficiary will help to contain this conflict and to prolong the pause and to stop Russia. And I will stop here myself. I still have a bit of time for your questions, and I really appreciate your feedback.
Do you have any questions?
Elita Cakule, Norwegian Association of Local and Regional Authorities. My question is that you as a researcher, you are, I think you asked very often to predict the future. And the recent move from the Council of Federation by Mrs. Matvienko to her fellow Council of Federation members to be standby, what does this move mean? Is it just a threat to Kyiv and a sign to Kyiv, or is it something going really on?
In principle, Russian parliament, both of its chambers, are not really big players and policymakers. They are very much a small-scale actor, but it's certainly not her initiative. And in this regard, yes, there is a connection between this move and what was granted to Putin after Crimea, a possibility to use military force essentially as he saw fit, which was later on kind of withdrawn. This is a response supposed to be to the new escalation of fighting in the Donetsk from which I started, which again is very difficult to pin on the Ukrainian side because essentially it's an offensive going towards Ukrainian forces. Nevertheless, my short-term expectation is that yes, during the summer, we'll see another summer offensive on the Russian side, because essentially Putin has caught himself in this security dilemma where your situation worsening if you do nothing, where you need to regain the initiative, where you can win only if you play white, when you have advantage of the first move, and that's kind of your key asset, you cannot give it away. With the expectation, there will be a news kind of surge of fighting, new spasm of conflict, and then the Minsk 3 negotiations, and maybe another spur, and then Minsk 4 negotiations. And I'm not sure whether there is trust enough in the West to continue along this path. At the same time, very often you hear from the politicians, we have no other way. We still need to find a way to manage this conflict. We know pretty well now what Putin is about, but we cannot go into war. We cannot really, it's not our war. Ukraine has to fight it. And to what degree it's able to fight it, it's a different question. It's not small Georgia, it's not defenseless Baltic states. It's a major European state of 40 plus million people. If it cannot mobilize enough energy and drive to defend itself, nobody else will. And I think, again, I'm not an expert in Ukraine, that step after step, defeat after defeat, Ukraine is getting its act together and will be able to show a better performance on the battlefield. It will be harder and harder for Russia to continue along this hybrid war where you can hide behind all sort of denials while doing all sort of dirty things. And Putin is reluctant really to go into open with this, with the real full-time war against Ukraine. Again, that's probably one of the strong red lines drawn by China, by Merkel, and by everybody else. But I still think we will have a hot summer in Ukraine. Yes.
Henrik Scheid with Eastern Europe Group.
Thank you, Pavel. I have a very simple question for you. Do you expect the EU to renew its sanctions?
It certainly, it depends. It depends how the situation on the ground will be developing. And this, I think, from the EU perspective, this should be one of the factors containing Russia. At most, we should be in doubt whether sanctions are reviewed or not, whether some sanctions may be lifted or not, and that should be something, this level of uncertainty should prevent Russia from going into a new escalation, and I think it would not. And it would not, and then the sanctions probably have been not just renewed, but probably increased, because again, it will be a blatant violation of the previous deal. And before the next deal can be reached, the EU will feel obliged to respond strongly, and probably the United States in particular. So I think the sanctions in this respect are difficult to evaluate what is their direct impact. You can probably measure their impact on Western businesses, but on Russia it is hard because it comes together with the fall of oil prices, which is a far stronger impact on Russian economy. For the first quarter of this year, the net volume of revenues from exporting oil is twice lower, nearly twice lower, than the first quarter of the year 14. And that's certainly a far stronger impact than the sanctions. And if this trend stays, the incentive sanctions might possibly be partially lifted. It's not very strong, not strong enough to contain Russia. So I think we probably much rather should expect more sanctions than lifting.
More questions?
Yes.
I think that should be the last. Do you think so?
I have one. Is it working?
Yes.
I have one short comment. We were a bit doubtful about if this was an war about area or not. You said between good and evil should be this. Who should be the good and the evil? But my many military friends tell me directly that this war is about area. Look at Crimea, look at the eastern part of Ukraine. Mm-hmm. The war is middle-aged type of war without marks on the soldiers, and it is about area. Clear.
You know, certainly every physical war is always about area. It is a battlefield. You need to move forward to win. In essence, from this tactical military point of view, there is no doubt about that. As far as kind of the other dimension of the war is concerned, how it is very often portrayed in Moscow these days, because the propaganda is massive and vicious. And you know, I've lived there in the Soviet times. I know what propaganda is about. I've never seen anything like that. It is really presented as kind of the clash, not just clash of civilization, but really this kind of colossal clash between forces of good and forces of evil. And so that's very different from what you see on the battlefield, where essentially on both sides of the of trenches, there are kind of basically Russian speakers, most of them shooting at one another. And who is of them is represents evil, and who of them represents good is very hard to say. So even if the war is very localized, in a fought about very small pieces of territory, we have to learn this microgeography of Ukraine with names like Debaltseve, Mariina, in the recent days. It has, at the same time, far greater dimensions. And in a sense, it is kind of Putin's, in Putin's mind, it's not fought for, he doesn't really need this Ukraine in the territory. He's not really interested in Donbass. There is no personal attachment to that. He's fighting against something very different. And if propaganda portrays that as a kind of battle between good and evil, probably in the Kremlin minds, it's a battle for regime survival. It is a battle for a very, very direct battle against the shadow of the specter of revolution, which suddenly appeared on the streets of Moscow after the fraudulent elections into the State Duma in the year in the last months of the year 11, which nobody expected, and came again on the streets of Kyiv, where Putin played a very smart game and thought I outsmarted them all with this EU association agreement. So that is where Putin's worries and concerns and kind of threat perceptions are.
Thank you, Paul.
Most unfortunately, I will not be able to stay for mingling. We have a few guests at Rio from China and from Korea. I have to be there. But I will stay for the coffee break.
Okay, that is a coffee break. Then there is a coffee break for 10 minutes. I suppose you coffee.
And I am a head of the International Projects Department in Norwegian Association of Local and Regional Authorities, in Norway known as KOES. And what is KOES? How does it work? We will try this. Yes. So, association is a member organization for all 428, for the moment, municipalities in Norway. And 19 counties, and we have also about 500 municipal or publicly owned enterprises as a members of our association. And the main goals of the association is having negotiations with the central government on the economic terms of municipalities and counties in Norway. And then what we are quite well known when it comes in the media, when we have a central bargaining with trade unions concerning the wages and working conditions in local government sector. And we also do assistance and consultancy to our members on different organizational, legal and economic issues. And we have a very small unit, five people working with international projects, and these projects are funded by Norwegian government, mostly by the Ministry of Foreign Affairs. And this also means that in Ukraine we work with the same type of organization as ours, and this is Association of Ukrainian Cities, which has status of a national association, which means that you have to have either the half of all local governments as a members, or you have to have about 50, more than 50% of the population within the members to get the status as a national association. So this association established in 1992. They have a main office in Kiev. They have also offices in all oblasts in Ukraine. And there, in Kiev, there are about 50 people working, 40 people working in this in the office. And what we do is, when we work with Association of Ukrainian Cities, we work as their consultant, as their advisor on different matters of all local government issues. So we do counseling, we do mentoring, we do guidance. We also provide best practices from Norwegian local government sector or from the national institutions in Norway concerning the local government sector in Ukraine. We don't do the job instead of the organization. And in this project, we have, in this cooperation with Association of Ukrainian Cities, we have a good and reliable partner in Norway, which is the neighbor, and Aadne will talk later about their commitment and support to this project, to the cooperation. What we have done since 2009, when we started cooperation with Association of Ukrainian Cities, we have helped Association to develop a counselor training program, which is implemented after the elections in Ukraine, local government elections. And what we do is also we work through municipal networks to improve efficiency of local government services. And through this, as we call it, efficiency networks, we also get the evidence-based policy development. When the Association of Ukrainian Cities talk to the government in the country. What we actually do, we have, we choose the service areas that municipalities have responsibility for. So far it has been mostly a primary health, which is a delegated function, and also technical services. And also this year was a local democracy issues. So we offer municipalities to come into the network. So mostly these are from 8 to 12 municipalities working in the network. So they announce their participation voluntarily themselves, those who would like to make improvement on their performance. Then we look at the resources and the inputs that are made into the provision of the service. What does this cost per inhabitant? So we also look at the availability of the services in the municipality. We measure, we develop indicators and we measure quality of the service. And we also ask, and what we also do, we ask the users of the service how satisfied are they with the service provided by municipality. So all this we put in the network and discuss the participants of the network, municipalities, discuss themselves and look at their results. They, through these networks, they learn from each other and find the best practices, and they set targets for improvement. They make a plans, and then they measure again whether their performance and the measures taken, whether they have improved the performance. So this is the methodology what we use in municipalities in Ukraine or Association of Ukrainian Cities too. And it was already 3 years ago when we developed the project application, we also put one of the networks on local democracy. What is the trust between inhabitants and politicians and administration in municipalities? And at that time when we made this this project proposal, so we could see that the democracy development in general in the country was going down. So there were invited municipalities that wanted to do something about it in their own communities to participate in this network. So we got, so we got altogether 19 municipalities that wanted to participate in this network. And here on the map you see only 15, and because the rest of them, they were on Crimea. So we lost them when we started on the, our first network the day after the so-called referendum on Crimea. And you can also see that these are municipalities both from the west and east that could compare the level of trust in the local societies between politicians and inhabitants. And Aadne will show you results and talk more about what we saw in different municipalities. But one observation is that there is no clear sign that in the west is everything much better and in the east is worse. So there are different municipalities and you see really the difference on the leadership, political leadership of municipalities. And then it was also mentioned that you also would like to know what's going on the reform processes in Ukraine, because Ukraine is now the same as Norway, is discussing, and not only discussing, but starting local government structural reforms. And as you can see, so we have more than 11,000 municipalities in Ukraine. And as you can also see that there is already a map which shows that at the end there is a projection it will be 1,400 municipalities. And there is already the date, which is 5th of September. And 5th of September is because local government elections this year are going to take place on the 25th of October. So in order to start the pre-election campaign, you have to start this campaign in a new municipal borders. And what has been done during approximately a year? There has been made changes in the legislation concerning the administrative and territorial arrangements. And there have been worked out methodology. And this methodology is adopted by the Cabinet of Ministers already in April. And in all oblasts, sorry, this goes too quick for me. And in all oblasts, there are established reform offices, which are connected with regional offices of Association of Ukrainian Cities. There have been already discussions with all municipalities, with rayon administrations, with state, with the state representatives in both on the rayon level and on the oblast level. And the plan is that there is going to be adopted by the Duma of an oblast level. One oblast, one new map, a new plan. So by 1st of June, two such plans and maps on the regional level have adopted in Dnipropetrovsk and in Zhytomyr. And 16 more plans are ready for adoption. In half of them, there are difficulties because two parties mostly, which is Batkevshchina and Svoboda, are against reform, and also some members of the party of the region. So they have vetoed the further process. And after the information that I got from, according to the information I have got from our partners there, so probably to solve the situation, the state or the cabinet of ministers will intervene in this process to get the plans through. And at the end, these plans before the 5th of September should be adopted by the cabinet of ministers. And also on some level, when we are talking about the rayon level and also on the regional oblast level, which are also in this reform process, are meant to be self-governments, which means with elected council and with supporting administration and with their functions and also based income base. So for these changes, there are needed also amendments of the constitution, which are in the process now. So this was very shortly on the general introduction, and I think I will give the floor to my colleague Aadne on the presentation of the results.
Thank you. Can I use this instead? Can I use that one? No. No. Okay. Hello, everyone. Thank you for having this opportunity to present some results from the research part of the Ukraine project. As Elita told, the main purpose of the research part is to support the networks that are working in through collection of indicators and conducting user surveys. But when we collect all this data, it's also possible to do some academic research. So we have, in collaboration with the Ukrainian researchers, we publish also some academic articles. And some of the results from the latest article that was published about local democracy in Ukrainian cities is what I'm going to present to you now. First, as has been mentioned, Ukraine is a highly centralized state, although many politicians and other societal actors see the need for reform, but there have been attempts to make such reforms, but they have never really taken place. And Poroshenko announced in his inauguration speech that there is a need to delegate powers from center to local governments. In this connection, it's important to say that this is a two-way process. You need local authorities who are accessible and accountable to the citizens, but citizens themselves also need to be active. We have studied exactly this interaction in our project. Local democracy is important in its own right because it's at the local level that people encounter their social challenges and also where they expect delivery of effective policies and solutions. But one can also see a broader importance that the appearance and application of democratic initiatives locally can lead to transformation of the social and economic sectors in a state as a whole. So it has importance also for the general democracy development. The Ukrainian institution guarantees rights of local communities to form local self-government. But there has been no comprehensive decentralization reform since becoming independent in 1991. And there is a law on local self-governance from 1997, which is, so the legal part is quite good, but the de facto centralization has actually taken part regardless of who has been in power since 2000. There is also a blurred boundary between central government on the one hand and local councils on the other. And therefore, population has remained detached from governance processes. Then a little bit about the survey that this builds on. It's a survey of 2,000 citizens and 225 so-called experts. Experts here, that means local council members and local authority employees, local governance employees. We conducted the survey in 20 cities, and 15 of those are participating in the networks. And in these cities, we also conducted surveys among the experts. They were linked to the efficiency networks, and we provided data to these networks about the results for each individual city. Professional pollsters, an opinion poll firm, was conducting the survey. And it was conducted at a very difficult time in Ukraine, in the July of 2014. And you have to take that into account when you interpret the data, because situation was quite different in different cities. And also, so in some cities, people were quite skeptical about answering the questionnaire. Nevertheless, we had always local pollsters. And now to some of the data. Or the results. Here you see the evaluation of local authority, of the responsiveness, how people perceive the performance of the local authorities. And on a scale from 1 to 4, they would say to what extent they agree or disagree with a statement. 1 is fully disagree. So here, it gives actually a very bleak and bad picture of how they see the performance of local authorities. It's for most of the indicators, it's near 2, meaning that they tend to disagree with most of the statements. They can be statements like people can influence decisions of local authorities and so on. I don't know, can you see them? Yeah. And what factors are associated with a low score for responsiveness? Yes, there are three, at least two main, and one slightly correlated. It's a low level of trust in authorities. Those who trust do not trust the authorities, whether it's at national or local level. They also consider that the performance is bad. Low level of civic participation, so people who participate more, they are also more likely to say that local authorities do a good job. Slightly, but not very big difference between east and west, but slightly more likely in south and east to evaluate the performance as poor. But there was no difference in terms of sex, age, education, and living standard. Now, the next slide is a little bit complicated. I will not go through it in detail, but it shows the difference between the respondents, the citizens, and the local authorities and the experts. So you can see there is a huge gap in how the citizens see the performance and how the local authorities evaluate their own performance. So for some of them, it's quite dramatic. For example, this one: people can influence decision of local authorities. Almost 90% of experts tend to agree with this statement, whereas citizens less, between 15 and 20% somewhere. And this, yeah.
And you were saying that the experts, local authorities, have kind of confessed that they are misusing their profession for personal gain.
Yes. Yes. Okay. Next slide. This is about to what extent people participate in civil life, politics, and so on at local level. And here we have from about 70-80% said they had participated in elections. They are not here in this slide. Here you have, there are lots of forms of local or ways people can participate locally, and results are not too bad actually. Meetings with representatives of city council, participated in citizen general meeting, these are 18, 15, 14, and legal demonstration. This was a very, activities during the past year, and of course this was a very active year for many Ukrainians. But we see huge differences between individual cities. How much time do I have? No, I had 15, so. Okay. This is a plot, it's called correspondence analysis, and I will guide you quickly through it. It's quite interesting because it's a tool that uncovers underlying structures in the data. And it provides a visual presentation. So far you don't understand anything, don't worry. it is so that categories that are close to each other, they are categories where people have answered quite similar, or groups of people. And if they are far apart, that means there is a big difference between these answers. And the next slide will show you. It actually consists of two dimensions. The first one, horizontal one, it goes from left to right. Here you have the, on the right side, you have people who are member in local organizations, participated in civic and political activities, and they are interested in local politics. Whereas the next dimension, the vertical one, it actually is interpreted as trust and responsiveness. So here you have people who perceive local authorities to be responsive. At the bottom end, you see the opposite. Okay, so now, based on these two dimensions, all different people and cities, age groups, and so on, can be plotted into such a visual plot. And if we interpret this, these four different dimensions, we would find that in the top corner are the interactive people who actually are both high on civic participation and who perceive local authorities to be responsive. Here you have the compliers. That is, we have interpreted those as they are low on participation, but they actually consider also local governance to perform quite well. Here are the protesters. These are people with high participation, but who are not who perceive the local authorities to perform poorly. And finally, the alienated, who have a low score on both dimensions. And what was very interesting is that we found that Ukrainian cities and also those participating in the networks are very, very scattered. Whereas you would find, for example, men and women, different age groups, as you can see, they are all in the middle. But the cities were scattered around in very different positions in the plot. So here you see the participating cities, and here you see where they are situated in the plot. These are then the interactive up here and so on. You will recognize it from the previous slide. Since I have little time, I will proceed. The positive finding is then that there are so-called interactive cities where there is communication and interaction between those governing and those being governed. And we find that this is correlated with the civic culture of the city, social capital, strong social cohesion in some of the cities. There is a danger of compliance, we argue in the article. Maybe people are happy with their local politicians, but they decide to leave politics, dirty politics, to the local politicians instead of participating themselves. This can be bad if the situation turns, of course, and so on. The policy implications would be then that there is a need, when we see the results, there is certainly a need to strengthen local democracy in Ukraine. And you need, since we find so very different pictures between the different cities, it's also important that you combine general measures with targeted measures to solve the specific questions that are at stake in the certain cities. Responsiveness you can enhance through training, transparency, anti-corruption measures. If their problem is a little participation, you can involve citizens, have programs for involvement of citizens in policy processes. And for those alienated cities, you need really broad information campaigns and educational campaigns for both local authorities and citizens. So this is two-way process, but as the survey and our data shows, it is possible. You already have interactive cities, and you can do something at the local level, even though the central level is lagging far behind. So this is it. Thank you very much for your attention.
Lagging a bit behind the program, so I think we quit questions here and you can take the questions during the mingling afterwards. Now we are talking about ourselves. We are talking about mainly what we have done the last month, and we will show you a film. You start with that? You start with the film.
You will understand what it's about.
Will I or will the audience?
Well, hopefully both.
Welcome to Business Matchmaking Portal, a platform that built to simple to use. On the main page dashboard, you can look through the list of all proposals. It shows the title of the proposal, which company made this proposal, the short description, what they're interested in, the category they're in, and location. So for example, a Norwegian company, a producer of fish, is looking to export their product to new markets in Ukraine. So we're going to filter all the proposals. Maybe there is a company that is interested in importing fish from Norway. First, we're going to choose a category that is most relevant for our search criteria. In this case, it's seafood. And we've got three search results. Since in this example, we're not interested in companies from Norway, we can exclude it from our search criteria. Also, we can use keywords to get even more relevant results. So let's enter import. And we've got one result that is most relevant to our search criteria. Now let's click on this proposal to open an extended view. On the proposal page, you can review more detailed information about the company. Visit their website by finding a link here. Also read the proposal description, which can tell you more about this company interest within this proposal, and download any included attachments. You can contact this company from here, and your message will be delivered to their responsible person. But in case you haven't found a similar business proposal, you can post your own, and by this go to Post Proposal tab. On this page, we're gonna fill out information about our proposal. We'll start from the title, which should be precise, and describe what this proposal is about. So it will be export of seafood. We choose category we're in, that the most relevant will be seafood. Description of this proposal. And we can also enter any attachments we might have. Price list, product specification, etc. So let's attach a price list. After that, we go to company details section and fill out information about our company. So we enter title, country, Norway, and let's say we are from Bergen. Link to our website. And also a short description, a general description about our own company. Be more efficient, and so our proposal will look more attractive. We're gonna choose a logo, and also we need to enter contact person name and email address that will go here. After this, there is an option to preview your proposal, and in case all the information was entered correctly, we go and submit this proposal to NUCC administrator. Within 24 hours, NUCC administrator will review your proposal, and in case it's approved, it will be posted on the dashboard. In case you need any technical assistance, or if the company you contacted doesn't reply promptly, please feel free to contact NUCC administrator with any question or suggestion. Thanks for watching, and hope this new matchmaking portal will help your business grow.
Yeah, we will soon launch the portal. At least, I think in August or September, maybe even before. It works already, but we will kind of start advertising for it and using it more actively after the summer. So I will tell you briefly about the Young Entrepreneurs Program. Now it will be repeated again the next year, so and hopefully the year after as well. The Young Entrepreneurs Program this year was a great success. We had 16 skilled Ukrainian managers and talents. They studied for 3 weeks in Bode, Oslo, Kiev, Chernihiv, Lviv. They learned about good governance, transparency, Norwegian-Ukrainian cultural differences and similarities, and Norwegian-Ukrainian business potential, etc., etc. We combined theory at the University in Norland and the Kiev School of Economics and Practice, together with excursions to companies such as Egersund Seafood, Itera, Elopak, Innocode, Vikborgrein, Innovation Norway, Virke, and some Ukrainian companies also, such as, for example, the berry producer Galfrost. This is from Bodø. I have a lot of pictures, be prepared. we also visited, this is also from Bodø. They started working on a business case in groups already the first night. This is Anastasia from Bodø. She's here today, I think, still. Yes, she's there. We also went to Oslo. Andre bought a selfie stick, very popular. Our office manager, Andre, there and there. We visited companies, as I said, such as Vikborgrein to the left, and had many lectures, for example, about social entrepreneurship, and also a very interesting lecture by our managing director, Sigmund Eckhaugen, about his experiences as a COO in Kyivstar and his views on cultural differences, etc. In Ukraine, we did much of the same as in Norway. We combined theoretical lectures at Kyiv School of Economics and lectures by organizations such as the anti-corruption watchdogs. We had excursions and we had practical work on the business cases. We also organized two conferences together with UCCI, the Ukrainian Chamber of Commerce and Industry, visited by 200 people in Kyiv and approximately 80 in Chernihiv. And this is from Kyiv. You know, always people are late, so we had to put chairs here as well. So it was quite crowded. So both of these events focus on agriculture and also on revising the bilateral agricultural agreement between Norway and Ukraine. This conference was also filmed and can be watched via our webpage or YouTube channel, if you're curious. The conference was a big success, and our vice president in NUC, Kristen Modal, also participated. We experienced an enormous interest, I can say, for NUC and for business, for doing business with Norway. So we were quite popular that day. Here is a picture from the meeting in Chernihiv, where we met UCCI, local government, local agricultural producers and exporters of seeds, grains, oils, etc. Here is Andre in action. This event was very practical oriented, very specific, and very useful for us to get an overview of potential exporters of agricultural products to Norway. We also had a meeting at the Chernihiv City Council. Also the Norwegian Embassy participated. We also took time for some excursion in Chernihiv. The city was visited by Norwegian Vikings many years ago, and there are several historical links between Norway and Chernihiv. A very beautiful city, by the way. We also visited a farm and more. I don't have pictures right now from our visit to Lviv, but that's also a very beautiful city, as you probably all know. And we had good meetings there as well, such as with the Lviv mayor, Andriy Sadovy, Innocode, Agro Lviv, Galfrost, Danish Business Association, etc. We had lectures by, among others, the parliamentarian Serhiy Leshenko, a good friend of us. We know him well, and he is now one of the new Ukrainians in the government. We also took time for some team building, yachting on the Dnipro River in Kyiv. Very nice experience. And all groups presented their business cases to the Norwegian side. I will very quickly go through a few of the slides now, and more, well, I think it's already 4 o'clock, so I'll be very brief. We had four groups. apple concentrate, tomato paste, berries, and seeds. They sold these business cases for specific Norwegian companies. The EU prices, if I push here, you see the EU prices for apple concentrate here. And in the next slide, you will see the Ukrainian prices. Also here, you see it's the same prices approximately. So Ukraine is competitive when it comes to apple concentrate. And TB fruit is the largest producer of apple concentrate in Ukraine with 55% market share. They live up to all quality requirements and can export big quantities to Norway for a good price. Also, there are a few smaller producers, but some of them are also absolutely interesting and have potential for export to Norway. The Apple Group also found the best logistics companies for apple concentrate in tank trucks and prices, 235 euro per ton. Based on delivery of 100 tons. So the prices can be better if you have bigger tonnage, of course. You see, unfortunately for Norway, it's more expensive than exporting to, for example, Copenhagen because of the distances. So tomato and tomato paste, the Ukrainian classification is harmonized with the European one, so that's very good. Ukraine is one of the top 10 tomato producers in the world. They export very little. You see the orange line here, that's the export, and the blue is the production. So 62,000 ton fresh tomatoes exported in 2014. Out of a total production of 2,148,000 tons. So for tomato paste, as you can see here, 23,000 tons out of 68,000 was exported. One full truck is approximately 20 tons. Due to the hryvnia devaluation, the cost of production in Ukraine has decreased, not only for tomatoes, but for most things, especially in the light industries with many workers, like, for example, the textile industry in Ukraine. For example, this, in my opinion, quite nice tie is made in Ukraine, and it's quite cheap nowadays. So the light industries, I think, can now decrease prices and make it even cheaper for us also to import. So also the tomato prices has decreased due to the devaluation. Norway imports much fresh tomatoes, increases by around 3% every year. Here you see our own production and here you see our import. Our tomato group found that the best time for Ukraine to export to Norway is October, November, but maybe also earlier, depending on what can be achieved in a revising of the bilateral agricultural agreement. As you can see, Norway protects our own production between May and October. You can also see that the EU has better duty levels here than Ukraine, and this must be changed, of course. Main exporters to Norway are Netherlands and Spain. As for tomato paste, there is zero customs duty. Norway imports 4% more annually, 50% from Italy, the rest from other countries. And here there's a big chance for Ukraine to enter the market because the prices and the quality are good, actually. And for the logistics, a truck is around 2,173 euros for 20 ton. Yeah, I will be quicker, yeah. Fresh tomatoes, la 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 la, quite competitive. potential exporters. The Ukrainian field tomatoes, yes, the field tomatoes in Ukraine, they taste very good, but they quite often look a little strange. And there are some rules regarding that in Norway, so it's not always so easy to import Ukrainian tomatoes. But there are some, especially the organic ones, and Ukraine is competitive when it comes to import of organic tomatoes from field tomatoes. Tomato paste, highly competitive in price and quality, ready today. Agrofusion, the biggest exporters, producer of tomato paste, but also others. Yes, berries also basically competitive in prices and quality for cranberries, blueberries, not so much for strawberries. Raspberries, yes, competitive, good quality control, logistics costs, refrigerated, 143 euro per ton, 3,000 per truck approximately. Biggest producers, good prices, kernels, sunflower kernels, flaxseed kernels, pretty competitive in both quality and price. Logistics, we already know. Here we see that Ukrainian firm Siavo, they have actually higher quality requirements than the Norwegian company X. So Ukraine can also compete on quality, if not all companies, then at least some companies. We of course have these as full reports in a Word document ranging from 15 to 30 pages with a lot of information. So this was just a very brief introduction. So we have a tool to use when or if Norwegian companies want to import such products. We know with whom to connect them in Ukraine. And we know if Ukraine is competitive or not on these products. You can also get in direct touch with the authors of these reports, two of them here. Me and Andre will gladly connect you with them. And next year we hope to have some more participants in this program. And next year also, if your company wants to have a business case solved by these talents, then please let us know and we will be happy to consider that. Inuk, you know, we also have a matchmaking program. You already saw the movie that we will soon launch a business matchmaking online portal, but we also work the traditional way to contact and connect companies. And mostly we prioritize requests from Norwegian companies who search for a partner or a supplier in Ukraine. We try to find the best partners in Ukraine for the Norwegian companies interested in such products or in different categories and sectors. We hope to hear from your Norwegian company soon. Do you want to find business opportunities, investment opportunities in Ukraine? Are you looking for it? Do you need some support for free? Someone to import from, someone to outsource to, someone to create a joint venture with, someone to export to, I don't know. Let us know and we will help you for free. We can also organize a study trip to Ukraine to visit different potential Ukrainian partners. We did this for a few Norwegian companies already and we will happily do it for you as well. Also I want to say, Sigmund, even if I know it's already 10 past soon, that for those of you who are members in our chamber, we would like to know if we can do anything more for you. We want to be here for our members and support you as best as we can, but we also need your active input on if you want us to do something special for you. So, in October, November, NUCC organizes a big conference in Oslo with special focus on investment opportunities and ICT, together with IKT Norge as a partner. And this is going to be a very big event with high-level speakers and participants, and we really hope that this will we will be at least 10 times more than today, I think. So this will be a big happening. So please follow our Facebook page and our web page to stay tuned about the exact date. We will also, as part of this conference, we will let around, I don't know, 5-10 Ukrainian companies present themselves and their business investment ideas, 7 minutes each, to the audience of the conference. So in cooperation with Kyiv School of Economics, we will launch a competition in a few weeks with some requirements, and we will choose the best investment plans we receive to present themselves during this conference in Oslo, October, November. My email address is here. We now have 3,200 followers on Facebook. You should be one of them, I hope. Please use us active to stay tuned about Ukraine and possibilities and development in the country we all like to see succeed. Thank you very much.
As we are 10 minutes behind, I'll be quite short. But as Arnfinn mentioned, we, based on the grant from the Norwegian Foreign Ministry, we will also do this program, Young Entrepreneurs, next year. This time, we did not have any qualified Norwegian applicants. We hope that we also should get the course of bilateral group next year, so we have both Norwegians and Ukrainians in the group. So if you have young people in your company that you think you are willing to spend 3 weeks on this free program, we really appreciate you contacting Arnfinn or Andre. We, as a result of the situation in Ukraine, Norwegian authorities has escalated their financial support to Ukraine quite substantially. So up till now, until the sort of the revised national budget is approved, and I think it is approved now, the foreign ministry has allocated 310 million to direct support to Ukraine. 100 million of it is budget support, but the rest is for different kinds of projects, both humanitarian and business projects. Business project within three areas, within rule of law, within energy, and within trade as a result of the Ukrainian-European Union free trade agreement. We have an application for support for this kind of these six activities. We don't know the result yet. We were told that maybe in a week or so. The reason I put it up today was I thought we had the acceptance to the before this meeting, but we don't know the result so far. But we have an application for continuing the program that Arnfinn was talking about. We want to make a Ukrainian business, Norwegian-Ukrainian business forum. We had one in Ukraine, in Kiev, last November when our prime minister visited Ukraine, and we would like to make a similar one in Norway. Hopefully, Yatsenyuk will visit Norway, and that should be a very good sort of timing for this kind of event. Then we have asked for support for three free business line projects, one on ICT, one on agriculture, one on fish. This is sort of mainly on export from Ukraine to Norway. This is on import from Norway to Ukraine and sort of processing, maybe also processing products in Ukraine for re-export to the European Union under the free trade agreement. And energy. We already have a project on energy where Henrik is a project manager, and we hope that in addition to the ICT conference, there will be a round table where we and the foreign ministry are now cooperating during this autumn, a round table on energy.
Q4,
yeah. That's actually the same that they're talking about for ICT. So this is sort of our plan. In addition to these two conferences, we will have one or two networking meetings during the fall. And we really appreciate you participating in that. That was the end of this program. I sincerely regret for those who are not supporting Vålerenga that we ended up in the Vålerenga meeting room. I have got a lot of complaints from people supporting other football clubs. We ordered another room, so I don't know why they put it here. So sorry for those who had to look at Vålerenga. And congratulations those who support Vålerenga. No, it's the Norwegian national team have the training out here, so we invite you to tapas to inform the discussion, and you can keep an eye on the soccer team at the same time. Thank you for coming, and looking forward to talk to you during the next 2 hours. Thank you.